payback. That is payback.
Hello, everyone, on this Wednesday in June. It is 1:03 p.m., and you are listening to In the Huddle Sports Radio on Can You Dig It Sports. I am your co-host, Zach Kroll, along with my guy, The Real Will, and we have a crazy, epic, epic show to talk about with you guys today. So many things to talk about in the NBA, and we are really going to be focused around the sport of basketball for today's show. And before we start off, I want to introduce not only my co-host, but our guest today. I'll throw it over to my guy, The Real Will.
Yo, bro, I'm telling myself to hold that big fat smile that I want to present right now because I am so excited to be here on this damn show today because last night, boy, oh boy, when I tell you, bro, ain't nothing like sitting back and watching a good game, all right? Ain't nothing like sitting back and watching a good game, a playoff game, a Western Conference Finals game. It was nothing like it, bro. It was a couple times I had to go to the bathroom and run some errands. But guess what, bro? When you're watching a good game, it can wait. And it sure waited to the end of that game. I'm excited. Can You Dig Sports Radio? Let's go.
Yeah, so before we start off today's show, I will actually introduce our guest. He is joining us for the second time in the last couple weeks. He's a great NBA mind that both Lil and I, yes, as big basketball fans, we really respect his opinion. And we thought that over the last couple episodes, we've been debating so much about the NBA, we thought it would be good to bring in a third mind to really talk to us about some reasoning. Give us another opinion. It's always good to have our guy, Isaiah, on. How are we doing, bro? How are we
doing? Thank you for having me. Love the show. I'm glad to be a part of it.
Absolutely. Thank you for coming on. Yeah, so absolutely. Will mentioned it. The Phoenix Suns, they defeated the Los Angeles Clippers by a final score of 104 to 103 on a crazy alley-oop to DeAndre Ayton for the win. And it's funny, Isaiah, because this is now the third series in a row that the Clippers are down 0-2. They've won the first two, and they deserve a lot of credit for that. But is it reasonable to think that they still have a shot to win this series against the Phoenix Suns? That is actually going to be the question on the table. And I'm actually going to start this off. I think the Clippers deserve a lot of respect. What they're doing without Kawhi Leonard, like the fact that they're here to begin with, is really impressive. Like, they deserve a lot of credit. Last year, the Clippers were up 3-1 to the Nuggets. We know what happened, and everyone flamed them, and rightfully so. That was a pathetic, pathetic showing. But I will say, in these playoffs, like, at least they're showing me some heart. I was a big believer in the Utah Jazz. The Clippers put Rudy Gobert in a blender and just exposed him. They deserve a lot of credit for that. They have young players like Terrence Mann that are just improving and getting better. So they deserve credit. But with that being said, I think that as well as Paul George played last night, and even though he missed the last two free throws down the stretch, overall he played a really good game, and the Clippers still couldn't win without Chris Paul in the Suns lineup. And I think that the Suns are too good of a team to let the Clippers back in a series like the Jazz did, like the Dallas Mavericks did. I believe in Phoenix, and with Chris Paul coming back healthy, I only think they're going to get stronger. So I just think the Clippers are going to run out of gas. I don't see them winning more than one game in this series. I think last night they really had a big opportunity to steal that game, and unfortunately they just couldn't get it done, and I think that's going to come back to cost them. I really do.
Yeah. Before I throw this over to Isaiah, I'm going to get this joint started right now, bro. First of all, the question at hand, do the Clippers have a legit shot to come back in this series? I do, but I'm still going to go with the Suns in seven. You know, I give that much respect to the Clippers and what they've been doing and how they've been competing. You saw Pat Beverly's defense yesterday on Booker. Muchas. Muchas, brother. I don't even know Spanish like that. Muchas. All right? Whatever that means in Spanish. Brother did a phenomenal job putting Devin Booker in check. This brother went 5-for-16 yesterday. Devin Booker, who's supposed to be your best player, especially when your leader is out. And that tells me all I need to know. Isaiah, I want to know your thoughts on this, because I love working with Zach. Zach is a good co-host to work with. I have fun all the time debating with Zach on topics. But sometimes my co-host could be a little bit hard-headed. I told this brother that Nikola Jokic has a right and should have won MVP, even though he did. I'm glad he won MVP. I wanted to see CP3 get nominated. I thought he should have deserved nomination for what he did. And I know his track record of teams that leave, you know, he leaves teams and they become a lottery team, or he brings lottery teams to the playoffs. But, man, if this team is something, the Suns, they built their foundation in that bubble, all right? So even though CP3, what he brings to that team, obviously cannot be denied. They still build that foundation in that bubble. They went undefeated in that bubble. Devin Booker was coming into his own. Mikal Bridges had a good year to close out that year last year. And Ayton, obviously, actually being healthy, could evolve this year. And you got Cameron Johnson and all those guys, Cameron Payne. So my theory is, I'm glad Jokic won. Zach disagrees with me. He think that CP3 should have won MVP. I want to know your thoughts on that real quick before we go back to the actual game.
Of course. Well, Jokic had a monster season, so we can't deny what kind of season he had. And I think we spoke about this before. CP3's impact on any team he's on is astronomical. Like, it's on levels that we don't really see on many superstars. You know, we look at the KDs going to Brooklyn. We look at other players, but we don't see them bringing these teams that are so low in their standings into the second place in their conference, you know? So I would have loved, like you said, CP3 to be nominated. But I think the right person won the MVP, which was Nikola Jokic. You know, not only his numbers, but his skill set and what he means to that team was beyond, you know, a lot of different measures. Even though I love CP3 and I feel like his impact greatly affected the Suns in a positive way, where everyone down the roster is playing extremely well and even getting a big confidence boost, and like Cameron Payne running the offense, which is beautiful to see.
Yes.
Well, before I even finish my thought, because I think Jokic was the right MVP, I want to give a kudos to Cameron Payne, going from someone who debuted on the Phoenix Suns team in the bubble, playing those 8 straight games, and then being on the roster into the next season and playing this level in the playoffs. The Bulls 3 years ago said he wasn't an NBA caliber player. You know, and I kind of like torpedoes his entire career. And the fact that he went from the G League to overseas, back to the G League, and now into the NBA and doing this kind of production, I love to see it, man. I just love to see it. But back to what I was saying, I do think the right guy won the MVP award. With that being said, the Clippers lost the game. As good as the Suns played, as good as the defense the Clippers played on Devin Booker, the role players on the Suns played, they stepped up. Cameron Payne with the 29. And I believe 29 and 8. DeAndre Ayton, when I was said, he's been killing the Clippers. You know, their paint presence is abysmal. They needed a rim protector. I've been saying this for years now. The Clippers needed a rim protector. Zubac is not the rim protector they need. Hopefully they address that in the offseason or whatever they do. But they needed big. You know, they brought in Boogie, and he's not a paint protector. He's a scorer. They need some kind of defense on the end of paint, because they have the paint, the perimeter defense. They need somebody to protect the paint. They lost this game. I disagree with Zach with Paul George having a good game. He missed 5 free throws.
I didn't say he had a good game. I just think that up until those 2 missed free throws, which were very predictable, he had the Clippers in a position to steal that game, and he couldn't come through. And that's what I think is going to cost the Clippers in the series. But go ahead.
Correct. He also missed 5 free throws throughout the game. You know, this is your star player. This is the guy you're paying the big bucks. Yeah. You can't be missing free throws in this kind of tight-knit game. Before that, he was shooting 1 for 8 from the 3. He made his first 3-pointer in the fourth quarter. So, you know,
throughout the fourth quarter, bro, don't you think he was making, like, timely shot after timely shot to at least keep the Clippers in the game?
He got to finish his job, brother. You can't have a guy working on your house and halfway when the house is built.
No, you're right. I think the main point that I'm trying to make here, guys, is, like, I kind of feel bad for Paul George, because I think before, he didn't play great, but, like, he at least had his team in a position to steal the game, and I at least had myself thinking – to myself at least a couple points throughout the game last night, like, playoff P, is that you? Like, is this a sighting of playoff P? Obviously, we know what happened in the end, but it's just, that's why if I'm a Clipper fan, I'm so frustrated, because you had a chance to win that game last night. Phoenix was really winning throughout the whole game, right? And then the Clippers really shocked them at the end, got on top, and still the Clippers could not close it out. And I think ultimately, like, it is so hard to win an NBA title, let alone get to a finals, when you're down 2-0 in the first 3 series of the playoffs. Like, have we ever seen anyone do that without Kawhi Leonard? I just think the Suns team is too good. I think this series is over.
Yeah, and, we're quickly here, man, to touch on Paul George. Look, it's the same thing we see with Paul George. We all know he's talented, but when the pressure is up, when it comes to Paul George, and it's the pressure moments, it seems he fades away. Like, for example, entering tonight's game, Paul George, right? We all know he went 0-for-2 on the free throw line last night. But that happened just once this season, February 21st against Brooklyn, with 9 minutes left to go in the third quarter. All right, that's February. Why now, in a game that matters, you can't hit at least one of the free throws? You know, so it's the same thing with Paul George, and that's why I don't trust the Clippers. They need Kawhi at some point,
but you're, because
Kawhi is going to be able to take those shots and make those shots when it matters the most.
But then tell me why you have the series going seven games then.
I have the series going seven games because I like what I'm seeing from Reggie Jackson. I like the defense that I'm seeing from Pat Beverly. Plus, he's hitting three-pointers as well when he's open, you know? So I like the team that's constructed with the Clippers. I think they have a great team. They have great depth. So even if Paul George is struggling, like he did for the most part in this game, you see how they still was able to be in the game and probably should have won that game.
I agree with both of you guys. I mean, I think I think that Paul George definitely let his team down. Like, he's the star player. The role players did their role exactly how they planned it. You know, I don't think they expected DeAndre Ayton to dunk on Zubac all game. But, Patrick Beverly played Devin Booker extremely well. You know, even guarding Rondo, which was kind of strange to see. Guarding Rondo, how to guard Devin Booker and make sure to take away, you know, certain aspects of his game to make sure he doesn't score the basket. You know, scoring 5 for 16, Devin Booker guarding him, facet, when he just scored a 40-point triple-double to game one, that was a great defense. And I think Paul George was supposed to close out that game, and he needed to for his teammates to give him, like, to feel confident in him to be able to lead them just in case if Kawhi isn't 100% cleared for Thursday. They said game one and two he was out. There's a possibility he comes back for game three, but we don't know what Kawhi Leonard, the Clippers, are going to get back. So, you know, it's a scary sight for the Clippers right now. Like, they were down 0-2 before in previous playoff series. But the Suns team, as they shown yesterday, their role players are here to play. They're locked in, ready to go. I don't know if we see the same Devin Booker that goes 5-16 in LA. He might go for another 20, 30 points or even another 40-point triple-double game if it's needed. But like I said, it's a scary set for the Clippers right now.
Yeah, Zach. And another thing to add on to that point of why I think this series is going to go seven is because you alluded to it. The Clippers, he partially alluded to it. The Clippers have good defense, right? And we saw against Luka, Luka was cooking them up for two games, and then they was able to double-team Luka. They know how to make the adjustments defensively, and they're still a great defensive team. So that's why even through Paul George's struggles, I still have confidence that they're going to win at least two or maybe possibly three games in this series, and that's why I got the Suns in seven. But I want to know y'all guys' reactions to the actual play that won them the game, that pass to DeAndre Ayton. I think the Suns do have to, you know, show gratitude towards the referees, because without that challenge, without the reviewing of the play before, that play doesn't happen. You know, my guy over here, the coach, oh my God, Monty Williams, my mind is all over today. Monty Williams, he doesn't draw up that play without that, you know, timeout, that little timeout basically it was. You know, so what are y'all thoughts on that play? And what do y'all like from Ayton this year? I think this brother has literally took tremendous strides in the playoffs this year. And he's playing himself into a max contract in the future.
Yeah, Isaiah, one thing Will hinted at it before, right before we started recording. My main basketball sport that I watch is college basketball. I love the NBA, watch the playoffs. But I remember watching DeAndre Ayton his freshman year at Arizona and looking at this guy before I even saw him play. Like, this is an NBA body that is in college basketball playing at Arizona right now. And he lived up to the hype. He was the number one recruit in his draft class. But with that being said, he was drafted over Luka Doncic. He was drafted over Trae Young. Those are some really good players. And the Suns weren't really winning his first couple years in the league. And no one was calling him a bust because he was showing promise. He was putting up okay numbers. But he wasn't really getting that same attention as a guy like Doncic or even like a guy like Trae Young. But I think the Suns, like, the way they've built their team around him and Booker and a guard like Chris Paul and just really good role players around those three, a very good coach in Monty Williams, I think DeAndre Ayton is in a really good position to thrive. And that's how stars are born, with that rare combination of talent and a good culture and a good spot where you're in. As much as we love Luka Doncic, like, look at Dallas right now. They just fired their GM. They just got rid of their coach, and it feels like as good of a talent as Luka Doncic is, like, this guy just argues with everybody. And then you see DeAndre Ayton. He may not be the star that Luka Doncic is or, you know, be able to lead a team like that, but he is in a perfect situation in Phoenix, and I'm really impressed, man. He's impressed me more and more. And even without Chris Paul, he's really – showed me how much his offensive game and his offensive skill set has evolved. Like, he's always been really athletic and a sick rebounder, always been able to block shots. But last night, it was impressive for me that Phoenix was really looking towards him down the stretch for baskets, and that shows me a mentally strong player. I was really impressed with what I saw, besides from the sick dunk to end the game. That was incredible.
I agree with everything you just said about Ian, and the fact that he's getting this kind of playoff experience at 22 years of age is tremendous for the team, especially with the young core that they have in him, Kel Bridges, you know, Devin Booker, of course. And then, you know, I don't know if they decide to keep Cameron Payne, they let him go. But, you know, having a core group like that growing in this kind of atmosphere is beautiful to see. You know, it's only going to go up from here. That dunk was beautiful. You know, I foresaw that play happening, and I was saying it before the play happened, throw the alley-oop to Ayton because Zubac cannot jump with him. They don't have a player that could jump with DeAndre Ayton on that Clippers team. So if you could throw that alley-oop, he's going to get it, and he's going to dunk on somebody. And the fact that play happened was so lovely, because even the tactician Rondo is someone that's I would say his IQ is so high that there's only a handful of players who I would compare Rondo's IQ to. The fact that he didn't know that that was not a goaltending and he thought that they won the game was strange to me. I'm like, I thought someone like Rondo would know that, oh, they could go to alley-oop.
Let me ask you guys, as just basketball fans, like, we obviously haven't been playing at that high of a level as the NBA, but, like, you guys knew that that ball was up for grabs, right? Like, I didn't really think – it never came to mind that that was going to be offensive interference, right? Like, it just – I knew the Suns won the game with that. Right?
It was a live ball because it was a pass. So, it's like, once that ball's up there, it's live ball, so you could just do whatever you want.
Like, I didn't even had to think that it was a rule. I just knew, like, that's always in play, a dunk like that.
How about we give credit to Jay Crowder? Went for that pass. That was an excellent pass. He doesn't go in.
That was the second pass he made like that game because he did it before. So Zubac got dunked on early in the game. Exactly. So it's like, it's just amazing how this team is structured. And I think Jay Crowder's like, I think this is like probably comparable to when he played in Boston, like kind of like the IQ kind of sense where it's like he's like his idea is like all team oriented. He's
a winning player, man. He is a winning player. Getting to the finals. If Phoenix gets to the finals this year, it's going to be the second year in a row that he's going to be on a team in the finals. He was with Miami last year.
That's and it's the intangibles. Because sometimes Jay Crowder could go cold offensively, shooting the basketball. So everything that he does on the defensive end and, you know, getting rebounds, getting boards and finding guys, that helps you when the shots are not going in. And I like that. And the Suns are a great team to watch, bro. I love watching the Suns. They're probably my favorite team to watch. Literally watch their games because they have what I like, which is a mixture of that veteran talent and that young talent. Because you can't go young. You can't go all young because these guys don't have playoff experience. But when you can add a mixture of veterans, guys that have been on this stage before, to help those young guys evolve their game, use their talents, but show it in big moments, oh my gosh. And then they got the great coach that is obviously a great mind that can put them in great situations to win games like it showed last night. I love what I see from the Suns, and right now they are my favorites going forward.
Last thing, I just want to say one last thing. Monty Williams and Chris Paul, I believe Monty Williams is Chris Paul's first head coach in the league. They potentially might be in their first finals, which is lovely to see.
MVP, baby. MVP.
Here goes Zach again. I told you, the brother hard-headed sometimes.
All right, boys. Great job by the Phoenix Suns. Phenomenal game. I think we could all agree, like, that was one of the better playoff games we remember in recent memory. Payback!